as is our summer tradition, we have to help lead the pledge this evening, the National Junior ROTC candidates from Garfield High School.
All rise for the pledge.
Bad news is Cadet Stephen Lewis, who graduated last year, he missed the academy, and he did not get the, where'd he go?
Southern University.
He did not get the partial scholarship for the ROTC down in Southern University. He got the full scholarship.
Some community and school reflections from the last couple of weeks.
I had I was in Cleveland for our annual conference and had a chance to stand in for the superintendent as several of our students were making their way to China. And it was a joint venture with Congresswoman Fudge, along with Akron Public School, Warren School System, I believe, and another school system. Several of the superintendents spoke, and we had one of our young people also spoke about their experience in the program. The wonder thing about it, they started maybe with having scholarships for maybe 19. They had scholarships or positions available this time for 50 students to go. So it was a nice array of young people who were making their way to China and to participate, representing not only Akron, but other areas around our community. So Mr. Johnson, our STEM school, high school principal, was also there.
Just a couple of things for me. Had an opportunity to attend Summit County Public Health hosted Everyday Democracy here to talk about racism and infant mortality. I'm sure that it was a very good group who assembled to have this discussion, very diverse. I think we had a couple members from Akron schools that were there. A good start to a good discussion. There was discussion about really expanding that whole dialogue in a broader context for the community, depending on the leadership of Akron's tolerance for having that conversation. I'm pleased to say that the leadership of that piece with the Summit County Public Health is being led by one of our own, James Hardy. And so there is a follow-up conversation on August the 3rd for those who are interested in participating in that conversation. I also attended the 38th Annual Reginald White Scholarship Luncheon at Trinity Church, hosted by Police Community Dialogue under the direction of longtime community activist Charles Walker, who is the director of Police Community Dialogue. And our guest speaker was Sam DeShazer. I don't know if you've ever heard Sam DeShazer talk before, but he's an amazingly engaging fella. There's probably not a piece of history about Akron, Ohio he doesn't know. And even if he doesn't know, if you just listen to him talk, you'll believe that he knows. It was a very good event. We had several students who were awarded scholarships. There was only one student that actually was there to receive a scholarship, Christopher Smith, and his junior, and his dad, a graduate of North High School this year, will be attending Akron University in the fall, received a $500 scholarship. I also had an opportunity to participate in a third grade reading academy. There were several of them going on across the city, across the district, I should say. On Friday, I went to Glover. As a part of the academy, the kids learned about Rome. It was just amazing to go in and hear them presenting to their parents and other folks who came to the academy about all that they learned. And I actually wanted a Rome kit. I don't know if I can get that kit. But you can tell that it was very interactive. I mean, they were talking about Rome. Some, it seemed like they'd almost been there, talked about. They not only read about it from a reading comprehension standpoint, but got to do a few things like mosaic tiles, and so those are decorated across the room. So I just wanted to give a shout out and hats off to Director Otley Kelly and the rest of her staff across the district who did a phenomenal job. From all preliminary accounts, attendance was very well throughout the academy, as well as I think there's been some testing.
Map testing? Yes.
So we're looking good. Finally, I had an opportunity to be a part of the phenomenal event that happened last evening here in Akron, Ohio. The citywide altar call. Me and my sinful brother here, Patrick. It's hard really to describe what happened, but it was wonderful. And I don't know about nobody else, but I felt a shift, and I was glad that I was witness to whatever is being birthed in our city. I just wanted to give a shout out to the many faith leaders, elected and community officials, as well as the many brothers and sisters across the faith who had the courage and boldness to step out and follow what they believe God had them to do. It was a beautiful event and a beautiful coming together. Finally, I attended the dedication of the historical marker of Akron Urban League, which is quite a befitting honor, being that they're celebrating 90 years of service to our community this year. I think it was most significant to me because I was one of those kids who went to the Urban League. And it was something magical. I don't know if magical is the word, but something really special about the Urban League because it was kind of centrally located, and so it was really no turf. Everybody came from everywhere just to assemble. And it was a nurturing there. I kind of honed my skill as a swimmer at the Urban League. There were things to do, there were enrichments, and there was a place where the life of young people were being spoken into. And so the impact the community, the Urban League has had on this community for so long has been great. I wish we had more entities, and I hope that in the future we'll have more entities that do the work that Urban League has done. So hats off to Urban League.
I just have one thing. It really wasn't anything that I went and participated in, but I received an email, and a Akron Public School alumni who graduated from Buchtel High School by the name of Lillian Prince. She was the class of 1992. She has a master's in education and biostatistics, and she has a program called the BRAIN program, and this program is going to take six underrepresented minority students to Kenya, and they're going to do some work over there to help with the medical profession, and they're going to be also dealing with the people's eyes and checking out their eyes. And I don't know all about all this technical stuff, but it's going to be a great opportunity, I know, for our students. And so six of the students from Buchtel High School will be attending, six males, and who were selected. And that will be the week of July 31st. And they're asking all of us, if possible, if we could give donations. They're talking about eye drops, allergy drops. They're talking about gauze. They're talking about vitamins and so forth. And there is a website that they have that if anyone wants to donate monetary or other donations, they can do so by going to www.brainprogram.org. And I think we should all try to support our students who are going on. It'll be a great opportunity for them to be exposed to another country, another folk way, and be able to give back to the world and people in the world. So let's try to support these young people as they go to Kenya. Thank you.
I do want to give a shout out to Mr. Flesher, who did arrange for board members and the Joint Board of Review, the superintendent, to do a hard hat tour of the Firestone CLC, so the Firestone Litchfield building. Yes, it is all one building. Yes, it is all Firestone. I keep saying that up and down until we have to stop saying it. It is an incredibly large and incredibly well thought out space. This is the first hard hat tour I think the board's ever had. I don't know that we ever got to go through as a whole board, at least at this state. Last, when we got to go see King, they were at the smart board phase, so they were putting in electronics and floors and things like this. But there were some spaces that were a little rough and a little scary and muddy, but it is going to be an amazing building, and I wanted to thank him for arranging that. I know that we thoroughly enjoyed it, and can't wait to see the progress. He's promised us another as we get closer tour. And it was good to see what things are still needed and that the work is coming along. I think you said 55%, they said, is complete. So it's on track, even with all the rain, and there was a lot of mud. And he's doing a great job of getting that building along. I also just want to say I did get to go take a tour of North High School this weekend. It was the all-school, all-years reunion for the Vikings. And saw Mr. Alexander's picture still hanging in the hallway. It was good to see that that's still there.
Did it fall?
It didn't fall.
It hasn't fallen off yet. And to be back in the building was wonderful. And a shout-out to their custodial staff for making that available, and to their principal for making that available for generations of North High grads. That was really a nice treat. I actually saw parts of the building I had never seen before, which is amazing to me. So thanks to for both of those building tours. It was kind of interesting. So next on our agenda, we do have a request to address the board. And Mr. Otto, as I understand it, you do want to discuss personnel, correct?
Correct.
All right. And so in order to do that, we do need to go into executive session. So I do need someone to make a motion pursuant to Ohio Revised Code Section 121.22G1 to consider to consider the complaints against an employee or official of the school district.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and properly seconded. Any questions or discussion? Hearing none, roll call, please.
Mr. Alexander?
Yes.
Mr. Brown?
Yes.
Mrs. Meansfield?
Yes.
Mr. Miller?
Yes.
Mrs. Sims?
Yes.
Reverend Walker?
Yes.
We are back in regular session. And now it's time for our communications and recognition, and simply, just
okay. I am not the speaker today, but I will be introducing, we have with us Nicole Robinson of the Kent State University WIC Poetry Center. We had a wonderful partnership with Kent State University and the WIC Poetry Center this year, coordinated by Dr. Nguyen. And I know that Mary Kelly is familiar with this program as well. Students from Lawndale, Janice, and
Garfield
participated in poetry writing sessions. I had the opportunity to visit the university, and you're going to hear exciting news about the work that they completed, as well as some upcoming award that one of our students will be receiving. So I present to you Nicole Robinson, Kent State University's WIC Poetry Center.
I don't ever know where to stand in these rooms, because at some point my back will be to someone, but this works. So as you kind of summarized the project for the most part, right? I think that's fantastic. So for the past 10 weeks in spring semester, teaching artists were placed in 10 different classrooms, and then also 2 classrooms covered at the Juvenile Detention Center of Summit County with Ms. Ruth Edge, educator through Akron Public Schools. These weeks were phenomenal, not only for the reasons that you can imagine, poetry helping students find their voices and tell their stories, but also interweaving Common Core standards, and all while the students are, you know, telling their story about where they're from and where they're headed. And the Lawndale students, we worked with 3rd, 4th, and 5th grade classrooms there. The 4th grade class had one really spectacular student that kind of shined out when I was looking through all of the poems to select this year's Annisfield Wolf Book Award Young Poet. Has anyone heard of the Annisfield Wolf Awards here? It's a gem here in Northeast Ohio put on by the Cleveland Foundation. For the past 80 years, it's an award in diversity. Langston Hughes, you might be familiar with that poet. Rita Dove, Akron Public Schools alum, sits on their jury. And each year we have one young poet featured, and Josiah from Lawndale Elementary will be there. Each of these students, when they came to Kent State University, I know you were able to make it out, with the exception of our youth at the Juvenile Detention Center, but the other students that came out, they just talking with them and sitting and hearing about their experiences, how when they found out a poet was coming, they were like, poetry, you know, for the most part, to be honest with you. But then as they went along, having fun with the teaching artist, having this visitor, having the elementary teacher saying to the poet, we're having a difficulty with division this week. Can you incorporate that into poetry? And having a visitor come in, I always say it's like the auntie of the classroom, right? They're coming in. They're not grading necessarily, but what they're providing was invaluable. So I'm just so thankful to all of you for your support in this. At the very end of the project, we put together published, perfectly bound books from each of the schools. Because of keeping everyone anonymous at the Juvenile Detention Center, what we did is created this fantastic online publication that Judge Theodosi signed up on. That is called Voices of Dan Street. And if you just put that in Google, you'll find that. It's powerful poems. I encourage you to do so. And there's also powerful poems here, so I'd like to present these to the board, and you can pass them around. And we will also get some to the administration. But thank you, Carla, and to all of you for your support. This has been phenomenal for about, I want to say the stats were over 215 students in Akron Public Schools. So, and just saying that number gave me a bit of goosebumps. So great work and great partnership, and we hope to continue it. Thank you.
Garfield on our purpose. These are beautiful. I can't wait to read some of the poems.
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
It was very inspiring. On a gloomy day.
All right. Now we need to approve our meeting minutes, yes?
Move.
Second.
All right, this would be for both the regular meeting for June 22nd and for June 29th. Any discussion? Hearing none, roll call please.
Mr. Bravo?
Yes.
Mrs. Mansfield?
Yes, for June 22nd, abstained from June 29th. Can I do that?
You may.
All right, thank you.
Mr. Miller?
Yes.
Mrs. Sims?
Yes.
Reverend Walker?
Yes.
Mr. Alexander?
Yes.
Superintendent recommendation.
Madam President, I have before me for your consideration 56 personnel recommendations, and I would like to point out two adjustments. In item number 4, the effective date of that hire is being changed from August 10th to August 3rd to reflect the alternate schedule that Akron Early College High School has, which starts August 3rd. And then in item 51, the termination benefits date of 6/30/2020 is actually the disability retirement, is an SCRS termination date. We're replacing that with the APS termination of benefits date of 6/30/2015. And also, I have in the supplement number 1, the list of high school graduates for the June class of 2015. Other than that, these recommendations are in proper form and I move their approval.
So moved.
Second.
Mr. Properly seconded. What questions do you have about personnel? Yes, Mr. Miller.
Question number 7 on the new position for the manager of testing and assessment. I guess the question is, we've been rolling along without this position, and you know, we've had testing juggling from year to year, it seems already. So I guess the question is, why now?
With the last year, with our own MAP assessment and with park assessments, it is just way too much of a load. You know, we have our director of testing, evaluate, research testing and evaluation. That position is really primarily geared towards all the research requests we get, and then our OGT and graduation data, which you all get reports on. This position, which would also report to the director supplemental education, will deal with all of the MAP testing and planning out, because these are all online, and now we're going to AIR testing in place of PARC. That's just a huge demand on one person, so we need to have another person deal with that. I mean, all of our third grade reading assessments with MAP, the third grade reading tests and other OAA tests, all that this person's responsibility will be to map that out to the entire district.
So is this a permanent position? Or
yes.
It's a permanent position.
The feeling was that this one should be at this level.
Yeah, absolutely. Because it's also all of the, summary of those tests and doing the reports on where we are in terms of the statistics, who's passing, and you know, all those other statistical means that they need to use in the evaluation of those to make sure we're meeting, you know, our internal metrics and also the state's.
Is this position in the grouping of positions that we have talked about
earlier this year, the end of last year, when you had brought us sort of an outline of when we had discussions about additional positions that may...
Right, no, this is absolutely a new position.
Any other questions? Yes.
Well, to continue on number 7 then, I guess this is not specific to number 7. It was about a year ago, we created there was 2 new positions we created, I believe, last August. And I guess as a board member, we've really never had any kind of official follow-up to hear the success or not successes of those. And I guess maybe at some point in time, I'd like to hear that to make sure that, creating the administration positions, we're getting bang for our buck and they're going as you thought, since they were basically new positions.
Yes.
And I also had on the graduation class list, I was curious if at some point in time, I'm curious to see how many of... Like, we had a couple different Excel spreadsheets, but I'd almost be curious to see as well how many of the kids graduating this year, how many ninth graders in this, the number of kids, how many ninth graders we had when these kids were in ninth grade, to see not necessarily what the graduation rate for just the 12th graders are, but you know, what's our attrition over a four-year time period? And actually, you know, that same class, maybe going back to seventh grade or something, because I know, you know, that's where the attrition happens. And just seeing the kids from the start of 12th grade to the end of 12th grade, 90, they're all in the 90%, I think, except North High School, but I don't think that's, in my mind, not really a true picture of the graduation rate, I guess. I was wondering if somebody might be able to.
We had that discussion during our instructional policy, because right. We asked the same thing. Right, okay. Even just to even quickly compare this graduation with last year's would have been helpful to see. But I think it gets at that question. We talked about closing the achievement gap. It's constantly a moving target if we don't look at that picture. So what was the cohort of ninth graders, and are they still here? And who are the people who peaked in, came in, left, so we can remove those folks so we can get a clear picture? So I think that's the, that'd be really helpful. I think we got some helpful data recently, but one was in a graph chart, the other one were numeric, and I couldn't really compare the two really good. So it'd be helpful to kind of make them mirror one another.
For what it's worth, I had similar notes on the graduation, so I think that would be excellent to see a little broader picture. Mm-hmm. At some point, and maybe that falls in one of the committees, or maybe it's a presentation here. I don't know.
Our committee, we talked it. I wanted to say we talked about that.
Every as we get data from the state, usually it's later in the summer, Mr. Black will provide a report on our graduation success and what those numbers actually are.
Thank you. On item number six, the revision of the name and the position description for that position, is there also a change in the salary range or just
the name and the position?
Right, that's not a change. That's actually another new position that's grant funded from the LeBron James Family Foundation.
Is that 90-10? Did I see?
Yes, okay. Absolutely, okay. In the dear board member letter.
Okay.
Mr. Superintendent, not to make, give us more work to do, but just wondering, even starting with this ninth grade class, maybe if there was some way to just pilot something that would help us starting now. I don't know if I'll be around to see 4 years from now, just to see that clear, you know. I mean, going back and recreating the data, not recreating it, but compiling it, may not get at what I think, for me, will help in terms of me really seeing that whole gap thing addressed. Would be helpful to maybe intentionally look at that. I don't know if that's something Mr. Howard does. I don't know. I'm not giving you a new job or anything.
Okay.
Any other questions on personnel?
We do.
All right, roll call,
please. Mrs. Mansfield?
Yes.
Mr. Miller?
Yes.
Mrs. Sims?
Yes.
Reverend Walker?
Yes.
Mr. Alexander?
Yes, abstain. Item number
8. Mr. Bravo?
Yes.
All right, next, Madam President, I have before me for your consideration 4 motions and 14 resolutions on the consent agenda. These recommendations are in proper form, and I move their approval.
So moved.
Second. All right, we've got a motion and a second.
Yeah.
No. any questions about consent? I'm sorry, Patrick, go ahead.
One of the things that we have talked about before with regards to item number 17, the STEM high school operational expenses. When we sold that building for to help fund the Innovation Generation Scholarships, one of our priorities has been to make sure that we found an alternative site for that. I mean, just in the rough numbers that we were looking at when we agreed to fund that, I know that I had expressed that my concern was that if we filled out the full 10 years of that lease, that we were going to look at spending up to 40% possibly of what we sold that building for just to lease that building back. That's still my concern, and I see $350,000 to fund a portion of the operational expenses for that building. I think it would be good for us to get to look at, again, perhaps in Finance Committee, a breakdown of the monthly and annual operating costs for that building, and to make sure that we keep it a priority to locate an alternative space for that, lest we find ourselves in a 10-year lease. So,
just no, wanted to Mr. Fill that. Fleischer provide a report on that information before it to
I just wanted to comment on item 9 on the consent agenda, pay it forward.
Yes.
Just really like the concept of because I think it really exposes our kids to nonprofit world and make them more conscientious about the work that's being done. But the thought came to mind, how would this work if we did a program that was more entrepreneurialism in nature for our students, that money was available to seed a project that they have. Kind of turning that around, when you think about small business and you think about entrepreneurialism, maybe using that same concept, because it's a very good one, to turn that and use those seed dollars maybe to seed a project that the students themselves may have. I think it would offer the same kind of PBL experiences and kind of really tap into some creative insights that the students may have.
Okay. Well, and I wanted to make a comment on number 9 as well, but one thing that we do is we do have junior achievement in the Akron Public Schools, and that's in essence an entrepreneur program, so that's there. But on the service learning, I just get my bandwagon. I would love to see that be some kind of service learning requirement for every graduate in Akron Public Schools and other places, Toledo. And I know we've had discussions with David and Dan Rambler on that in the past. And then I will just chime in on Patrick. I can't go without my annual dissatisfaction with the lease at Central Howard, and I will leave it at that.
So yeah, we'll hear this again.
Yes, because we have to give 18 months to get out of it. So
I thought I like junior achievement, but it didn't kind of get at what I'm getting at, but I appreciate that. Thank you, Mr. Tim.
So the other thing that Tim and I both said in a session at annual conference one year where they talked, I believe it was annual conference, where they talked about, I think it was Toledo.
Toledo, yes.
And one of the things that something like this also does is it helps people realize, you know, you get that, all those rotten kids out there, blah, blah, blah. And when you actually can document all the good they do in the community and show what they're doing, what it does for the community's attitude about the kids changes too. I'm always amazed at how people say, oh, I don't like teenagers. They're this or that or the other. It's like, when's the last time you talked to one? When's the last time you spent time with one? They are not, you know, they're probably way better than you were when you were a teen. So it does do that as well. So I would agree that both initiatives would be a good thing. Any other consent questions? Hearing none, roll call, please.
Mrs. Mansfield.
Yes, please.
Mr. Miller.
Yes.
Mrs. Sims.
Yes.
Reverend Walker.
Yes.
Mr. Alexander.
Yes.
Mr. Bravo.
Yes.
And next, Madam President, I have before me for your consideration 32 business affairs recommendations. These recommendations are in proper form, and I move their approval.
So moved. Second.
Moved and seconded. Any questions about business affairs? Yes, Patrick.
Item number 23. What is the expansion? What is the increase? I mean, I see it says total cost not to exceed $600,000. That's an extension of the length of the contract. We provide adjustments for compensation.
Right, there's no increase in
the
cost.
So there's an expansion of the length of the contract and adjustments in compensation. Is there a decrease in cost?
Not at this time. Is it all, what the city has requested is we need to review that contract. Mr. Rambler and Ms. Porter have been going through that contract to make some adjustments. And the city at this time has not had enough time to review some of those changes. So this is just to allow the contract to work as is while we work on those changes. but the expense is exactly identical as it has been over the last several years, not to exceed.
So if there is any adjustment and they come back,
then
it'll come back.
Yes, absolutely.
Go ahead.
Number 24, so this is, we don't have someone right now at the STEM.
Yeah.
This will be for the addition of someone.
No, actually, you did have someone assigned last year, and this was going to be a supplemental to be written in the similar format as the previous contract for APD, and because APD's was held up, this didn't get approved for last year. It's to pay for last year and this next year. So it will get through June 30th of 16 and then allow us to put an actual contract in there.
Okay. And that explains the
yes.
July 14th.
Yes, that is correct.
Got it. Number, just one more, Madam President. Number 31, I apologize. Sometimes I get a chance to ask for these ahead of time. Sometimes I don't. 31.
Yes.
Total cost annually to be $50,000 or more.
Okay, this is an actual agreement to allow us to take advantage. We are already working with BSN Sports. This allows us to go ahead and have this agreement for several years with these additional discounts. And the way it is written is we already pretty much expend $50,000. We just don't know exactly what we're going to do each year in those items that we would need. So say as an example, you might need football jerseys and basketball jerseys and maybe some cheerleading, you know, stuff this year, but you wouldn't buy it again next year. So this was our best estimate in working with them and reviewing the expenditures with Mr. Pendleton that we have done.
But just open-ended like that? I mean, when it comes to the board, just 50,000 or more, it could be 50,000 or 10 million.
That's the minimum part of their contract to participate in their rebates. This still doesn't supersede the board's responsibility to bid. So if we go out for football reconditioning and BSN is not the lowest, we do not take them.
Okay.
So it's not an obligation to spend 50. It's just if we spend 50, we get the rebates.
Thank you. It looked funny the way it was written. I thought, well, 50,000 or more?
It's just the way the contract is written.
Just a couple from me. Item 10.
Yes.
IEP edition.
Oh, okay. We pay maintenance and service agreements for this particular item, which is eSchool Plus. We purchased the IEP Plus part of it last year. So therefore, it is now time to incur that maintenance because it's no longer part of that original. So that's why it's being adjusted, to allow us to do maintenance for the new module that we have purchased for IEP Plus. The software for IEP Plus is for our special ed students, and the previous company, which was Encore and then went to Exceed, went out of business. So we needed to take that information, put it into a module that would work with eSchool Plus. So therefore, the first purchase gave you the maintenance as part of it. This is now to allow us to continue maintenance for that module.
Okay.
All righty.
Yes, ma'am.
19.
Okay.
Oh, Global Scholars.
Yeah, just the, what's it? Yeah.
Akron Council of World Affairs. That's the program where they bring in diplomats from foreign embassies, and they actually have sessions where they work with the students, and then there's a culminating program that evening with a talk with the students present and the community. So they actually get to interact with diplomats from different foreign countries.
So that's the student-based services?
Yes.
My question in number 23 is just a little different. Sorry about this, too. My question was more or less like outcomes, $600,000. What our measurables are, maybe that's in the contract?
The actual contract is for the placement of the selected police officers. Now, to get outcomes from that, Mr. Rambler and I, in fact, were talking about this earlier, he could give you some data as he's worked with these officers as to what those interactions are and the community. Is that what you're looking for as to what, how effective they are while they're there?
Yeah.
And that is something Mr. Rambler actually does oversee, and he could give you that data. But this is just to employ and pay them. That's all this contract is really giving you approval for. The data and the outcomes is something different that he can address as part of it. Okay? I don't collect it, so I can't answer it. This is just to employ them.
Okay.
All right.
Mr. Rambo, do you want to do that for an upcoming board meeting and maybe?
Sure. I would be happy to. This Officer Williams, I'll just put him on the spot from East SRO. And we were just talking in the hallway about there are other measurable outcomes that we could talk about, arrests of kids in the schools, incidents that they kept from happening, like weapons that they may have ascertained before they became an issue, which was something he was involved in a couple years ago. But then the other parts are the really good byproducts of the relationships they build and then the ability they have, not only in the school, but outside of the school, to be able to resolve things because they have that school relationship. But we absolutely can't. That last one I can't measure, but we all know it because he experiences it. But I can absolutely get you those kinds of things like arrests and incidents that they've resolved and just the safety in general that they've impacted.
Yeah, I'm just thinking about, even a discussion around the community, around police community relations, this would be a good piece to have if we have some information offer. I just didn't know what that was.
Yeah, absolutely. We can absolutely pull some of that together. And we collect a lot of that data of different events that occur throughout the year. We can absolutely share.
Okay. The last question. The item 29, the bid seemed a little out of place. I just wondered.
Why do you think they're out of place?
I mean, everything else seemed around the 80,000. The other one was like 52,000.
Actually, this particular company has done a state cooperative bid pricing, and this is the first time that we have been able to take advantage of this. This has thoroughly been reviewed by this, and they feel that they can do this. And this is actually the same state by contract pricing that they would get if I didn't go out for bid. I could actually go out and get this pricing through the state by contract, but they use that to provide it to us. All right. They're doing exactly what they need to do. The RFP is very specific as to when they have to test, when they have to go do service, how soon they have to be there. And if you approve them, we will be, Coney has actually done some installs on your new buildings, and this is the first time they've ever decided since installing that they would like to provide monthly service and yearly maintenance. Okay.
Any other questions?
I won't keep you here long. I don't know. Maybe that makes sense. It just seems.
You're afraid elevators are going to fall from the. Any other questions? All right, roll call, please.
Mr. Miller?
Yes.
Mrs. Sims?
Yes.
Reverend Walker?
Yes.
Mr. Alexander?
Yes.
Mr. Brava?
Yes.
Mrs. Meeks?
Yes.
Okay, Madam President, we have a couple of people we'd like to introduce.
All right. First up is Mr. Tom O'Neill. If you could stand up, please.
Bye, Gabe.
Mr. O'Neill is a graduate of our own North High School. He received a bachelor's degree in secondary education from the University of Akron in December 1992 and his master's degree from Akron U in 2006. He received a principal's license in May 2008. He did his student teaching in the 1992-93 school year at his alma mater, North High School, in English, and then began his employment with Akron Schools in 1993 as a part-time English teacher at Firestone High School. The following year, he was hired full-time. He taught at Elk High School for 1 year and then was assigned back to North High School, where he continued to teach for 14 years. For at least 12 years, he was the head football coach there and was also the varsity track coach. He has taught summer school. He's been an IET member, breakfast coordinator, future educators club advisor, student teacher mentor. He has been commended for embracing the use of technology in student instruction and for his involvement in many extracurricular projects and activities. For the 2009-10 school year, Mr. O'Neill was selected as an English teacher at the Akron Early College High School, which is the position that he currently holds, and tonight he's been recommended for the position of Dean at Early College. Congratulations.
I'd just like to say thank you for this opportunity for the board to Mr. David James. This is really an honor as a proud first-generation college student myself. And a product of Akron Public Schools. I look back at principals and coaches and teachers I had that made a difference in my life. And I know I wouldn't be here, where I am without them. So just to continue, you know, to give back to the district, to the students in this capacity is just a great honor. So, and I'm looking forward to working with Ms. Conley. We've worked together for the last 8 years or so just to support her and, you know, continue to, early college has been such an evolution, you know, from when it began and just to continue to grow that program and what it has to offer is just it's exciting. So I think I go back, the change was August 3rd, so I'm counting down the calendar. I think this is, I always look forward to going back to school, but this is really kind of special for me. So I'm not just saying that, it's just, I mean, I do, it's I like teaching, you like being with kids, so. But so in this capacity, I'm really counting the days down. So thanks again.
I just want to comment, I'm glad that he's an Akron school graduate, but more proud he's a Viking. But I've watched Mr. O'Neill for years, being involved with Akron Public Schools in various aspects for over 20 plus years. But I've seen him and his brother, but I've really seen him do a lot for kids and go the extra mile, which is what I personally think that educators, that's a real educator when you go above and beyond of what just it says you're to do to help kids. So I want to congratulate him and say I appreciate it.
Thanks.
Keep going, Maggie.
All right, next up we have Mr. Aaron Dehart. You can stand, please. Mr. Dehart is a graduate of Orville High School. He received a bachelor's degree in industrial management from the University of Akron in 2000 and then earned his master's degree in educational leadership from Ashland University in 2007. In February of 2015, he earned his principal's license. He began his teaching career in 2001 when he worked for Kansas City Schools as a long-term substitute teacher at Lathrop Elementary School. In 2003, he became a full-time language arts and social studies teacher. While in this position, Mr. Dehart founded the Varsity Club program for at-risk students. This program focused on goal setting, decision making, academic achievement, and social skills. He was then assigned to Harder Elementary, where he participated in the building leadership team. He then moved to Lehman Middle School, where he used the Collins Writing Program to engage students in writing better essays. He has also served as a head basketball coach and head football coach. Mr. Dehart most recently was an 8th grade language arts teacher at Oakwood Middle School in the Plain Local School District, and tonight he's being recommended for a position of dean and will be assigned to Jennings CLC. Congratulations.
Thank you. Administration, appreciate the opportunity. I'm really excited to get going. I'm like you. I just told her a little bit ago, I'm ready to go back already. You get really excited about it. Unfortunately, I've been sitting at home with my 7-year-old, and she's ready for me to go back to school. Again, I thank you for the opportunity. I'm ready to get going to join this mission in progress. I truly am. Thank you.
What's the leap from industrial management to language arts?
What is the leap of it?
Industrial management.
I thought at one point I was actually going to be working for like a Volvo Corporation or BMW, working as a, and someone caught me and said, you know what, you really need to take a look at education. You've been coaching, you've been doing it. Actually, I started coaching at Firestone High School back in 1989, shortly after graduating high school, and I always kept coaching. And then I had coaches tell me, you need to get back in education. So it's a passion, and that's where I am. Thank you.
Welcome.
Hey, I just have to make these comments. I'm glad that we have another African-American male. I mean, I'm not racist by any means, but if you look at all the statistics and things are going on, even if you look at our statistics that we put out, at the graduation rate, look at all the African-American students that are graduating. We need that balance, so I'm glad that we were able to find another African-American male, and hopefully there's more so we can kind of balance. And I think as that continues to grow, that we're going to see more progress in Akron Public Schools, positive progress. So thank you.
Anna Hewley, next. Ms. Kiana Hewley is a graduate of John Adams High School in Cleveland. She received her bachelor's degree in psychology from the University of Akron in 1999 and then earned a master's degree in curriculum and instruction from Cleveland State University in 2002. In 2008, she earned her educational specialist degree in supervision and administration from Cleveland State University, and in March 2009 received her principal license for grades 4 through 12. She began her teaching career in 2003 when she was employed as an intervention specialist for the Warrensville Heights City School District
and in this position, she planned the curriculum, wrote IEPs, and created learning materials geared to her students' abilities. In July 2004, she was employed by the South Euclid-Lyndhurst School District as an intervention specialist. While in this position, Ms. Healy developed appropriate lesson plans, adapted materials to meet her students' needs, and worked with other professionals to establish behavior plans for her students. She's continued in this position until the present time, and she has also served as the special ed coordinator for the district. She's now being recommended tonight for a position of dean and will be assigned to Litchfield Middle School. Congratulations.
Thank you. It's always weird to hear things about yourself. So, wait, did I really do all that? Okay. So I just want to say thank you. I am so excited. This is a life-changing event for me. I was in my last district for 11 years. Thought that I would be there, and I just took a leap of faith. So thank you.
Couple of items, Madam President. One, I'm happy to report that Charisma Community Connections, which is the lead organization on the Community Connectors Project, received a Community Connectors grant in the amount of a little over $109,000. And I'm also happy to report that Project Grant Akron also received a Community Connectors grant. And I want to say it's in the amount of almost $70,000. So, who will be partnering with us in terms of providing mentors to our students. So, we'll have a report, a presentation to the board, I believe, the first meeting in August. Also, I just wanted to update the board on a couple of issues with the budget bill. You know, the legislature passed House Bill 70, which is the Academic Distress Commission changes, which for failing districts would appoint a czar, and that came to the attention of the Senate with no or people speaking to testify. You know, that was pretty much blocked, so it passed. And there's a lot of issues in that bill which would take some of the authority away from school districts like a Youngstown that are in academic distress and make a lot of changes, not only to the contracts that districts can enter into, like labor agreements or purchase contracts, but can also close schools or turn schools over to private operators or convert parts of a district to charter schools. The other one is on charter school reform. The House failed to pass House Bill 2, which would have given some increased accountability to charter schools that many of us in the Ohio 8 were looking for, like the audit provisions that we have to undergo every year from the auditor of state, is to just have those same requirements for, you know, other schools, but that did not pass. We'll be keeping a close watch on both of these. We'll be meeting as a group with the Ohio 8. We usually, in our September meeting, have a sit down with the state superintendent, and so we have some questions about both of these, and we'll seek some input and guidance.
David, does the charter one actually make it out of conference to a vote?
That one, I think it did, and then it just failed in the House. Right. Exactly.
Now, the status on the distress bill, is that something now that the governor has okayed, signed, or is it still?
No, it's our understanding that that was not taken out of with a line item veto. It was actually included in a community learning centers bill, so that is law, and that, you know, it's going to impact probably some more districts as we move forward.
Right. I think it's thoroughly disappointing too that instead of sometimes looking at a district like, say, Youngstown and understanding the situation of those students and those families and understanding the challenges that they might face and maybe addressing those, the first response is always to look at taking local control away from the school districts.
Right.
Rather than
rather than doing the flip, which would be to put some resources towards, you know, anti-poverty initiatives and other things that challenge those students so they can't come in and learn. Because I think it's even being out in the community as part of, you know, a re-election campaign this year and listening to feedback from the community, you know, my son goes to Case and I've talked with other, you know, we've referenced other schools in conversations where, you know, the community seems to think that, and this gets to the whole rating system of schools and the evaluating schools from the outside, that, you know, these parents have it's like the grade of that school or the rank of that school or the designation of that school is a reflection of the people inside that building, and it is not. I mean, when I walk into Case Elementary or any other elementary, you know, the designation on the outside of that building that says they're, you know, this grade or that grade, or they're effective or they're continuous improvement or they're, you know, the new gradings, that's not a reflection of the teachers and staff on the inside, but it is a reflection of the things that the children and families that go there have to deal with on the outside. And I just think that it's thoroughly disappointing that somehow that, you know, makes it through with no opposition and just sails right through, right past the governor's desk. And I think it's just one more attack on local control of public school districts. And I hope we pay attention to that, and I hope that we come up with our own solution to combat it. And I feel those districts' pain, so.
Yeah, I think continuing to have the conversation, because if it passed like this, I mean, we're all subject. If something, all it takes is something that sparked their interest or, you know. So we need to be talking to our representatives as well, both Washington and locally, to our local officials.
Well, the march started, you have Cleveland, you have the ongoing conversation with Columbus. Now you have a trouble spot, Youngstown, and as you're saying, instead of figuring out what really is the problem, how can we correct some things, how can we undergird some problems, social, economic, et cetera, no, let's put I would consider the easy way, let's get rid of people there making decisions, let's bring somebody else in who doesn't know anything about the community, doesn't know anything about the people, but will look and make decisions for the people closing schools.
And by the way, that could be a for-profit charter school company who's going to be subject to the same, not subject to the same, you know, oversight.
Which every report that we have gotten, independent survey and reports, that charter schools do not fare any better than our worst schools. Right. So, I mean, they are not doing the job. In fact, they're doing it worse than what we consider some of our worst schools. They're worse. So to then give them the option without having the accountability, none of the accountability. You have the money, you get the resources, but none of the accountability as a fix for something that you need to look at in a whole different way. There's been a lot of things going on in Youngstown.
Right, right.
Just looking at all the aspects of things that are going on, and to then just say, okay, we're going to take local control. So I mentioned that some time ago about the push towards taking local control away from us.
Right.
We've been elected by the people. Come November, hopefully some of us will be reelected. We have a responsibility to take care of what we see meets the needs of our community. And we've got to fight. It's unfortunate there wasn't any opposition, that no one spoke up if they knew. A lot of things are happening and being pushed through that we don't get information enough to rally, because other people have done their homework, because they've decided what they want to do ahead of time.
I'm glad you brought that one up. That's really what I wanted to say.
It's sad for Youngstown. They do have a lot of other issues that affect their school system, and that's outside of what the educators are doing, so there's nothing they could do. I mean, sad, real sad. All right, so I'll be the president.
Well, I saved my comments specifically because mine were very similar to that. I was actually on vacation, and I was in a place
where I had very little access to the internet, very little access to news, and what came across my feed was a few things about these bills, and trying to get information and trying to understand what on earth had happened was absolutely amazing to me, thinking, okay, I missed a step. But coming back and reading through things and finding out what swift changes were passed along with the budget, in a manner that, you know, can only be, you could almost consider a kangaroo court. It was as fast as they possibly could. What I want to do the most, rather than just complain about it, is I want to encourage parents to not just get involved. And that doesn't just mean complaining to us. That means understanding what's coming up. I know this year was a huge change and a huge shift for everyone taking on PARC. The district had been trying very hard to explain, this is what it's going to be like. This is what it's going to look like. We spent a lot of time trying to educate parents. It's very difficult to go to a meeting and sit through what the testing is going to be like. I talked to a parent from out of state,
because it was my 30th class reunion
this weekend. And when I was talking to them, I asked, well, what testing do you do in the state you live in? She had no idea. This is a parent that was involved. This is a parent that, you know, has kids that are graduating. They're making it through. And you know, upper middle class, I would consider, suburb of Atlanta. No idea what tests her kids were taking. No idea. Yes, they had to take a graduation test. Yes, she knew her son was taking. She had no idea what it was. And I would just encourage parents to please pay attention. Please try to understand. If you want to ask questions, there are so many people that will help you. If it's not one of us, we will put you in touch with, you know, Mr. Black or Dr. McWilliams, or if it's math testing and things like that, Mrs. Kelly, so they can explain it to you in a way that maybe we can't. But please get involved and don't keep letting this happen. The fact that the speed of reform that could take place so quickly in one vote for public schools, when we've got a charter bill and reform that we can't even seem to get them to really take a serious look at, or keeps getting bogged down in a committee, or that can't pass the House, is absolutely laughable. And I know people are angry about that, and they're really finally starting to pay attention. But I would just encourage them to please, as we're heading into this new testing and we're trying to explain it, please come when we have those meetings. I'm going to be there because now I have to learn all about AIR. And I remember when we were there, the state was trying to decide which one to do, sitting through sessions. You know, we weren't sure which one, way it was going to go. But please come and please be a part of the conversation and be part of the understanding, so we can all get through this together. Because it's going to be, it was mind-boggling to be outside of the loop a little bit and try to understand what was going on. So please get involved and ask questions. And I know, along with this, Mr.
I think that's to the point that Patrick makes, too. You know, we're ingratiating this all the time, and it always throws us for a loop. I mean, it's hard to teach a child who's hungry. Mm-hmm. It's hard for a parent to stay focused on all these changing dynamics when the rent is due. So I think we still have to address those issues of poverty. Without right. that, we're just shooting craps in the dark. And so I think sometimes we end up putting an onus on parents. It's hard, that's really, I shouldn't say, I don't want to say it's not theirs, but it's difficult for us. I mean, this right here boggled our minds. You know, I'm just still trying to put my arms around AIR and PARC. And do I park and make some AIR? I mean, I don't know which one to do. You know what I mean? And so if they're faced with all these other dynamics, violent, all the other stuff, it's really, really hard. And so I think because they elected us, that's what I'm saying, for us, we have to be talking as elected members to our legislative members, to other community groups. We're faith-based. We work with them all the time around education. So that we keep the heat on. So, you know, I respect certainly everything you're saying, but it's so hard. I think it gets back to the issues of how do we support them in the community and meeting some of those emergent needs so they can focus on
education. And my point is more not that they need to do something about it as much as we are here to help explain it, that we have the right people that will help you understand. Don't hesitate to ask, because I'm going to be asking them these questions. I'm not going to understand it completely either as we're switching, because it happened so fast.
I can't imagine what the whiplash was like in these offices during those days. It must have just been amazing. All right, and I know Mr. Pendleton has updates because of this same vote.
I feel like I'm just going to pile on to this conversation. As you know, we entered the end of June with some positive momentum on the budget, and in the true form of what we've been talking about, last minute, as of June 30, we took a little bit of a departure, specifically with the Senate and the Conference Committee, as well as some line item vetoes in the budget. So your administrative staff really has spent that time since July 1 going through and figuring out the impact. Try not to be too cynical, but I will tell you that the full impact of last year's budget wasn't fully realized in the documentation that we got from the Ohio Department of Education until April of this year. To give you a kind of example of how long it takes to get through Columbus, really to reflect and for us to reconcile our numbers. This handout is the start of my five-year forecast update. I'd like to do that update to you in a much abbreviated format from the May forecast, the second board meeting of August. This highlights the differences between the May and the new budget revenue estimates only. There's no expenses in there. We still have things to talk about like Ed Choice and the expansion of Ed Choice, which will have a major impact on our forecast. So the difference in the green above in your handout, and I put a few extra handouts there, this is also what I shared with senior staff in just a little bit more verbiage, is what we had forecasted in May. And then what's in blue is in law now. And so it kind of tracks what we've been trying to do month to month in all the financial reports, what's the pluses and minuses. And I put a box around the years in which I would like us for all to focus on, and not so much 18, 19, and beyond. The major departure here is the elimination of tangible reimbursement. That tax ceased with House Bill 66, was phased out, and the state realized it was too harmful to districts, so there was a state reimbursement. So it was kind of like a guarantee. And the governor had said in the very beginning of all of his introduction and testimony that he was going to be eliminating this, and he did. So that was, I think even my predecessor in our first few meetings, we talked about what would happen with the elimination of that 5.6 million. So that day is here today. So that 5.6 million you can see is fully phased out by 2017. Basically the formula eliminates half of it for this year and half the next year. You can see that in the section. Let me talk about a couple positives so that I'm still bringing on everybody here on this lovely Monday afternoon. A couple positives. For the first time in many years, we're talking about the formula in terms of not just property tax. So before, Ohio took 614 districts and it ranked them on wealth based on property tax. So we know post 2008 there was a major change in property valuation, and whether it be commercial, industrial, or the 9 years that our taxpayers have faced with declining home values. It's been 9 years. So this income factor that's a part of the formula now is a good development, and hopefully it's going to be built on. So I can detail that more in the August presentation, but now we're looking at median income compared to the statewide average, and it's used in calculating. That's part of why we were estimating a 7.5% cap on our new funding formula. So we are receiving additional money, and it is good work to increase there. Down at the bottom of your handout, under number 4, I'll also just highlight special education categorical amounts are not capped and they're not guaranteed. They're increased at 2% each year. K through three literacy aid. This kind of goes along hand in hand with the third grade reading guarantee. The state's putting the money there and they're backing it up with 5% each year. That's outside of the formula. There's no cap to that. And then career tech and the expansion of categorical amounts there is 4% each year. Again, I drew the box around the 2 years that we should really be focusing on. You see the net impact, again, to the May forecast. I'm going to highlight that because it is an increase over last year's funding. But you can also kind of see the headwind that we have in 2018, 19, and it's going to be 2020 when we roll over the forecast for the new fiscal year. So that compounds another 15 to 17 million that we're going to have to back out of the forecast, of the May forecast. And I think that's enough.
Any questions before we let Mr. Fleming go off the hook? Something in the air today. Okay, committee reports. We do have, I know, legal and core policy has on first two.
Yes. For the first reading of three, prior approval is the 2015 Rules and Regulations of the Board of Education, which is revised. And each of you have a copy of that, and you'll see in the packet the blue where Ryan has took a lot of time, and he's met with me, and he's taken. We've taken into consideration all that you wanted to have changed and see changed in the booklet. So if you see, read through it, see if you see anything, and then we'll go from there. Hopefully, we may not have to go through three readings. We might be able to bypass future. And the next. Is the second reading of three readings prior to approval, which is policy 5136, personal communication devices. They've been working hard on that too. So, and Ms. Ryan and Emma and Howard, everybody. So,
second. I do want to point out real quick. I had asked a question when we got our documents electronically. Some of them were blue and some of them were red. They were all intended to be blue. That's one of the reasons that it was printed out today. So if you saw some that were red and you're looking for those, they're not in red anymore. They're all in blue. And I know there were some folks that had some questions. So
a couple different questions. And actually, I'll start out with a real easy one. It's more of a request. If I could have my name changed to Tim Miller on the last page instead of Lee Kennedy, it'd be great. Editorial comment there. Under organizational meeting, question I have, and this is in blue, it states at the organizational meeting board, and I'm on page 5, the very top. At the organizational meeting, the board shall appoint a designee to attend public record access training required for board members for each term of office. And my question is, I send a designee, do we send 7 designees? 1 designee for all of us?
Just 1 for all of us for each term. And really this is...
What's once every 2 years then?
It is. It happens about every 2 years depending on if there's a resignation on the board.
Right.
This just keeps us able.
Okay. I couldn't wrap my head around that.
But if you choose not to, Rhonda takes this training every year, and I know I do.
And my other one is, and we've had this discussion before, on the distribution of board materials. I personally would like to get them sooner than Thursday evening. That's me personally. I like to digest things over a longer period of time. That's the personal comment. The other one is that I'm wondering how that dovetails with the speaking privileges of non-members. Because somebody from the community, in order to address the board, has to ask to address the board by 5 o'clock on Thursday, which is before we actually get our board packets. So if somebody in the community wants to speak on something that we're going to vote on Monday, they don't have knowledge of what we're going to vote on Monday because the board packets don't come out soon enough for the public to actually see those, which I think is sort of, you know, anti-constituent, anti-public, if you will. So I would like to get them sooner just for my benefit to read and digest things. And I think it sort of conflicts with the public's ability to comment on something before we vote on it, because the way it is now, they don't see it until we vote on it, and then it's too late for them if they have a problem with what we're voting on.
It is too late for them to speak, but as we do know now, I mean, in times past, it would have been too late for them to get us a letter or maybe even find our number and get a phone call. We are pretty accessible by email, so I know I've had lots of notifications, but I agree with you.
But are the board packets available to the public before today?
That's good.
You pick it up if they hear.
When is it available electronically? I don't
know. When does it go on our website? It goes out after the board meeting on video, doesn't it?
Friday.
It is on there Friday.
I was going to say something because I don't want us to take up the whole meeting. This is something for us to read, and if you have the questions, and please send them to Ryan and myself, and we'll look at them and get it back to you as well, because that was the whole purpose, so everybody can get this here, read it, digest it. If you have any questions, get back to us so we can address those questions that you have.
Because we had questions before, but we see it's still kind of the same.
Then let us know about that as well.
What's the process for amending this? We don't have to stop doing the readings. We can make the amendments without...
Yes, that's why we want you guys to contact us, let us know. Ryan and I are going to continue to work. We've been working on this even though it hasn't been brought here. But we'll look at it again, see what your comments are, go back in here and say what did we do and how can we address it, then address it to make sure you guys get it back again, okay? I mean, if it takes three readings, it'll take three readings. We just have to go, you know. But if we can get it done sooner, we'll get it done. If not, then that's what we'll do. We'll wait for a third reading. But you guys send us the information as soon as you can, because you have this time to read it, digest it, and then send the information back, because we got your information and we tried to address it, and we may have not addressed it as we should have, or maybe you want us to. So help us out so we can do that.
Okay. I prefer my comments in the future to be in red. The blue, I just don't like.
You don't like the blue. Men's sensibilities. Any other questions or comments about this? All right, let Mr. Alexander and Mr. Pendleton know. I appreciate your hard work on this and on the cell phone policy as well, and hopefully we can get those folks taken care of. Deb, when's the absolute drop dead that needs to be handled so that it can go out in time for school to start?
Actually, to be honest with you, we planned in the handbook that says we just follow policy 5136.
Okay.
So therefore, it makes it very nominal so we can go ahead and do that. And in the handbook, it's actually listed under the transportation section. So once we get it done, we'll get it posted and put out to all people when you guys decide to finalize the package.
Very nice. Finance and Capital Management Committee, any reports?
We didn't have a meeting in July. Not that there hasn't been a flurry of activity for us to keep our eyes on, but we didn't have a meeting in July.
Can we go back to our regular schedule August, though? But that'll be prior to...
Okay.
And anything from instructional policy and student chief? Any unfinished business or new business? All right, so again, I need a motion pursuant to Ohio Revised Code, section 121.22G1, that we go into executive session in order to consider the investigation of charges or complaints against the employer, official, and school district.
So moved.
Second.
Any questions or discussion?
Yes.
All right, hearing none, roll call, please.
Mrs. Sims?
Yes.
Reverend Walker?
Yes.
Mr. Alexander?
Yes.
Mr. Bravo?
Yes.
Mrs. Mansfield?
Yes.
Mr. Bravo?
Yes.